Und ich habe
Sag mal, du hast nicht zufällig einen Präsenter zum die Folien durchklicken.
Ja, habe ich heute nicht mit. Okay,
passt.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Today we have a shift of program, so the first speaker is not here, so we're going to shift everybody. So we're going to start with the first speaker, Markus Dice. He will tell us about state-to-state chemistry of a few body processes in ultra-cold domain.
Okay, so hello everybody. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for this wonderful event. So my name is Markus Dice. I'm from the Institute of Quantum Matter from the University of Ulm. And my talk will not be about atom-ion collisions, but on how to exploit an atom-ion hybrid setup to get information about other reaction processes. So the title is State-to-State Chemistry of a Few-Body Process in the Ultra-Cold Domain. And what we do is essentially given already on this first transparency. So we investigate three-body recombination of three neutral atoms forming a diatomic molecule. And this molecule together with the remaining atom carry away the released binding energy. So for this diatomic molecule, this is what we are interested in. And we would like to observe the population distribution of these molecules formed in the three-body recombination process. So as a motivation, we want to do state-to-state chemistry, which means that we prepare the reactants in precisely defined quantum states. Then reaction takes place, and the products are also kind of produced in precisely defined quantum states. And we exactly want to measure these product states or even control the formation of particular product states. Our testbed are ultra-cold quantum gases, which means that we work at temperatures of about 1 microKelvin. And this allows for the control of the initial states on the quantum level and to tailor to collisions in terms of geometry, collision energies, and the scattering length. So what we want to do is to gain a fundamental understanding of chemical reactions and possibly to gain control over reaction processes. Okay, so in our experimental setup, we use a crossed optical dipole trap. And in this dipole trap, we load high-density atomic clouds of spin-polarized rubidium-87 atoms. So the density is about 10 to the 13 per cubic centimeter. Then in this high-density cloud, G-body recombination takes place with this reaction forming these diatomic molecular product states. As a number, about 85,000 molecules are produced in the first second of interaction within this cloud. Okay, the question now is, what are the produced molecular states in terms of vibration, rotation, and also the hyperfine structure? Yeah. So, this is related to the question, what is the population distribution, and what are the propensity rules for this reaction process? Okay, first of all, I want to give a simple estimate of the product population distribution. So what do we expect? Yeah. So in order to form a molecule, the atoms have to approach each other to about bond length. Yeah. In the ultra-cold domain, the typical distance for collision partners in a collision is given by the scattering length. Yeah. So we expect that the scattering length should about be equal to the bond length. Yeah? In other words, this means that for a large scattering length in the highly resonant interaction regime, only the most weakly bound molecular state is produced. So this is expected, and this was also predicted some time ago and also observed, for example, in these publications. However, we investigate small scattering lengths. So we are in a non-resonant interparticle interaction regime. And therefore, the production of more deeply bound states is expected. And indeed, some of these states were already observed in one of our previous works published in Nature Physics. Okay, so how do we want to detect these molecules? So we use a two-color resonance-enhanced multiphoton ionization. Yeah? So the scheme is as follows. We have the freshly formed molecules, then a first laser, the so-called probe laser, in a first excitation step excites these molecules to an excited electronic state. Yeah? Afterwards, a second laser, essentially two photons of this laser, ionize these molecule, and we have a molecular ion. Yeah? And so then afterwards, it is exactly this molecular ion that we detect in our setup. Essentially, this ionization laser is represented by our dipole trap laser. Yeah? So it's a strong laser. And this probe laser is just a tunable diode laser with low power. OK, in a potential scheme, the atoms are prepared in a 5s electronic ground state, given here. Then this three-body recombination takes place and forms molecules in this mixed X singlet sigma G plus A triplet sigma U plus complex. Essentially, in our detection scheme, we can only detect this singlet component. Yeah? And for the signaling component, I have kind of sketched the molecular level structure here. So this is the dissociation threshold. And then we count the vibrational states from this dissociation threshold downwards. And this R kind of gives the rotational quantum number, which means the mechanical rotation of this molecule formed. Yeah? So this molecule, then this probe laser excites this molecule to a well-known excited state. This state in our case is this A singlet sigma U plus state. And yeah, more particular, this vibrational level V equals 66. Yeah? This state has a particularly simple level structure. And this state, this A state, V investigated previously, so we exactly know the level structure and we exactly know the kind of the term energies of the involved levels. Then afterwards, from this state, two additional photons of this ionization laser are sufficient to produce this molecular ion. Yeah? So this ionization process works very well. The state selective part is given by this probe laser. Okay, now of course we have to detect this molecular ion, as I said, and for this we exploit the fact that we have a hybrid atom ion setup. Yeah? So in our experimental apparatus, we have a Paul trap. Yeah? And whenever this molecular ion is formed, it is trapped with about 100% efficiency in this Paul trap. Yeah? So whenever in this Rempe process we detect a molecular ion, we can kind of deduce the initial state produced after this three-body recombination process. Yeah? So in the Paul trap, how do we detect this molecular ion? So there we do not have fluorescence imaging because it's a molecular ion. Therefore we use another method. So we overlay the trap centers of the Paul trap with the trap center of the optical dipole trap. And then this micromotion driven ion in the Paul trap inflicts losses in this atom cloud due to collisions. And from kind of the number of atoms lost, we can infer how many molecular ions are produced in our scheme. Okay, now what about the results? So here, this is the Rempe spectrum in a range of 5 gigahertz that we observe. So this frequency nu is the frequency of this probe laser, which gives the state selective kind of excitation of the molecules. And we plot the remaining number of atoms normalized to the number of atoms that we observe when this probe laser is turned off. Yeah? So we see a large number of resonances, yeah, and the goal is now kind of to interpret these resonances. So the frequency reference here is given by this strong resonance feature given here, and essentially it turns out that this strong resonance here corresponds to the photoassociation line. Yeah? So photoassociation means that two atoms collide and together with a photon, an excited molecular state is formed. So this process does not have to do anything with three-body recombination. Yeah? It's just a single two-body process. However, this frequency serves as a reference frequency for our scheme. That is corresponding to the dissociation threshold. Yeah? So we know the dissociation threshold from this photoassociation line. Then we kind of can see the molecular states below this dissociation threshold. Okay, as another consistency check, we have performed the measurements where we turn the ion trap off. And there we also see this photoassociation line, which means that kind of at this frequency molecules are formed. Which corresponds to atomic loss, as these molecules cannot be detected anymore with our absorption imaging technique. Yeah? So, and we clearly see that here in this scan, only a single line is present, and this is exactly this photoassociation line, which where the frequency is in perfect agreement with this frequency observed in this Rempe spectrum. Okay, now what about the other resonance features. So first of all, we have to really check that these resonances have their origin in three-body recombination. Yeah? And in order to check that, so we look at particular resonances, for example, this resonance given here where this arrow starts. And to check whether it is three-body recombination, we perform a density scan, which means we measure the number of detected ions. And here, this number is normalized to the atomic number given in the cloud. And we measure this as a function of the atomic density. Yeah? And if we do this scan, we clearly observe a quartetic scaling behavior. Yeah? And this quartetic scaling behavior directly points to the three-body nature of this peak. Yeah? And we also observe this for other loss features. Yeah? For comparison, I have also plotted a linear fit. Yeah, this linear fit would correspond to a two-body process, and this linear fit is in clear disagreement with our data. Yeah? So we are pretty sure that we have kind of three-body effects present here. Okay, now in order to assign these observed resonances to the initial molecular states formed in three-body recombination, we use coupled channel calculations. Yeah? These coupled channel calculations were performed by our collaborator, Eberhard Thiemann from Hannover. And they are indicated as these vertical lines here. Yeah? So for each of these vertical lines, we have an assignment of the initially formed molecular state given by this vibrational and rotational quantum number. And this J prime quantum number gives the total angular momentum quantum number in this excited A state addressed via our probe laser. Yeah? And we see that for all of these expected transition frequencies, we see a resonance feature. Yeah? Okay. However, yeah, from this assignment, we can also kind of derive a first propensity rule, and this propensity rule says that we only find molecules with even rotational quantum number r, yeah, which corresponds to positive total parity. Yeah, we can see here only even rotational quantum numbers are indicated, and this is just related to the fact that there are no other transitions are plotted. Yeah, so we do not see transitions starting from odd rotational quantum numbers. Yeah, so only these even numbers are produced in this three-body recombination process. So as a check of consistency to our assignment, we use the fact that we have this given selection rule, which means that for states with r larger than zero, we should see two different transitions to two different excited J prime quantum numbers. So for example, if we look at this vibrational state equals minus two and the rotational state equals two, we should see a transition to this excited state J prime equals one and J prime equals three. So two of these transitions should be present. Now, if you look at our data, the corresponding expected transitions frequencies are given in these boxes, these lines in these boxes. And we clearly observe these two transitions. And also, they are of similar strength as expected for these transitions. So, but what about the other resonances? Yeah, so a large part of these resonances have a particular feature. And this feature is given by the following. So when we tune the dipole trap laser frequency, and the dipole trap laser frequency corresponds to this second ionization laser. Yeah? If we tune this frequency, we see that these resonances, which are given by the frequency of the probe laser, also shift. Yeah? So for example, if we lower the dipole trap laser frequency by, let's say, 150 megahertz, downwards, this frequency of this probe laser shifts up by exactly 150 megahertz for these resonances. Yeah? However, for the already assigned resonances, they stay at really their position. Yeah? So they do not change with this dipole trap laser frequency, but a lot of the other resonances they do. Yeah? And for these other resonances, we just kind of explain this by a kind of two-photon process, which means that so the sum of one photon of the probe laser and together with one photon of the ionization laser kind of resonantly hits an excited molecular state, and then another single photon kind of ionizes these molecules. Yeah? So these large number of other resonances can be explained by that. However, we still have some resonances that do not shift with the with this dipole trap laser frequency, and these resonances we attribute to more deeply bound states, but these are not kind of explained into in detail yet. Okay, now we want to look at the most weakly bound state. Yeah, this state is of particular interest, as in my motivation, I said that this state is kind of the only state populated in the highly resonant regime. Yeah? So what do we see for this most weakly bound state? This state is expected to be 24 megahertz besides the photoassociation line. Yeah? So if you look at this spectrum here, we can hardly see a resonance feature as it is drowned by this strong photoassociation line. However, if you look in more detail into this region, here I have plotted the ionization rate. So this is kind of this is now an inverse signal because we are not looking at the atom loss anymore, but at the ionization rate. So we see a peak and not a loss dip anymore. And after proper adjustment of experimental parameters, which means after properly adjusting the aspect ratio, we clearly observe this peak exactly located at 24 megahertz, yeah, corresponding to the most weakly bound state. In general, the presented method has a high resolution. Yeah, so in our scheme, we can observe peaks located or resolve peaks located close to 5 megahertz, close to each other. And this is mainly limited just by the laser stabilization. Yeah? So this allows us to resolve even hyperfine structure. Yeah? So now I look in more detail into this region given by this box here, where two transitions should be present. And essentially, each of these transitions has two components. Yeah, so there are two hyperfine components. And for each of these two transitions, these hyperfine components are kind of about 20 megahertz separated from each other. So the expected transition frequencies are about 20 megahertz separated. And this should be clearly observable in our scheme. However, what we see is that we always just find this F equals 2 molecules. Yeah? So we do not observe F equals 0 molecules at all in our scheme. Yeah? So this leads us to another important propensity rule. So this F equals 2 state is dominantly populated. This is also what we see for other vibrational states. So essentially, in all of our measurements, we do not observe this F equals 0 state. And this is remarkable as the, also the atomic scattering state has F equals 2. Yeah? So in other words, this means that this relevant interaction in this three-body recombination process is in some sense purely mechanical. So no spin flips are involved at all. Okay, now after this qualitative statements, we want to go to a quantitative analysis of the state population. And for this, of course, we have to calibrate our signals. Yeah? In order to do so, we use photoassociation. Yeah? If we kind of do photoassociation, we can deterministically produce molecules, and the number of these molecules we can measure. Yeah? So if we do so, producing these molecules via photoassociation, and then we have this ionization laser, we can see kind of the fraction of molecules that are ionized with this ionization laser. Yeah? And it turns out that this efficiency is about 10 to the minus 4. Yeah? We also know that this first transition here, this probe laser transition, is saturated. And therefore, the overall Rampier efficiency is given by this 10 to the minus 4, which means that 1 out of 10,000 molecules are ionized in our schemes. Yeah, this is not too much, but it is enough that we can observe these things. Okay, if we do this for kind of all of the resonances that we have assigned, yeah, we see the following results. So here I have plotted the three-body recombination-induced loss rate into individual particular states that we have kind of assigned. Yeah, these states are given by their respective binding energy. So we have done measurements for a range of about 17 gigahertz, yeah, starting from the dissociation threshold, and these are all the states that we have observed. Yeah, so here the vibrational quantum number is indicated by the color coding, and the rotational quantum number is indicated by the numbers given close to the data points. Okay, so for some of the data points, for some of the states, we essentially have two data points. This is just kind of related to the fact that we have observed these two transitions, and for each of these transitions, according to the given selection rule, we have kind of inferred the corresponding population. Yeah? For some kind of states, we just have an error bar, yeah, and this kind of This says that we have measured or tried to measure this state in the given expected frequency region, but for these states we did not observe any population. Okay, so not what are the overall results? Yeah, so in general, we find that still the most weakly bound state is populated the most. However, also more deeply bound states are significantly populated. Yeah, we see that kind of this population kind of follows an 1 over square root of the binding energy dependence. Yeah. So as numbers, as I said, the production of the most weakly bound molecules is favored. So about 50% of all molecules produced via three-body recombination are formed in a most weakly bound state. And we can estimate from this 1 over square root of binding energy dependence that about 10% of all molecules are more deeply bound than 17 gigahertz. In other words, this plot says that we already have observed about 90% of all population produced via three-body recombination. Okay, now what about the rotational distribution? Yeah, so for example, if we look at the rotational distribution corresponding to this vibrational state, V equals minus 4. So we see here the following two results. So first of all, the reaction can create a significant molecular rotation of up to 6 quanta of rotational angular momentum. Yeah? This is quite remarkable as the atomic scattering state has R equals 0. Yeah? So we really see a creation of rotation. Yeah? As a second point, we see that there's a large variation of the population with the rotational quantum number R. Yeah? This large variation is also expected from theory. Our collaborators in the US, so Brandon Rusick and Paul Julian, they have a numerical model, and they also see this large variation because of interference effects between the kind of the entrance channels in their calculation and the output channels. Yeah? So their interference can go on, and this kind of leads to this strongly kind of varying populations of this rotational levels. Okay, so what about these numerical calculations? I do not want to go into too much detail here. I just want to restrict myself to just present the results. These results are given by these crosses here, and here we see kind of some part of agreement and some part of disagreement. So the agreement is that also in their calculations they see this 1 over square root of binding energy dependence. Yeah? And also, as I said, they see this large variation with the rotational quantum number. However, if we look at particular states, we sometimes see discrepancies. Yeah? However, I would say the overall agreement is quite remarkable if one considers kind of the limitations in the calculations. So these are three-body calculations which are notoriously difficult. Yeah? So they are kind of limited to a certain number of bound states that they can include. Yeah? And in view of this and also kind of considering the experimental uncertainties and limitations, I would say the agreement is quite remarkable. Yeah? So I mean, these three-body calculations, so they are state-of-the-art calculations. However, I mean, they are still kind of limited. Okay, so with this, I come to the conclusion. So I have presented a highly sensitive, highly selective method to detect diatomic molecular product states. And we detected this method for the three-body recombination process of three neutral atoms. Yeah, so for this process, we could kind of determine propensity rules. And these propensity rules are that no internal spin flips are involved. The total parity is conserved. Sizable molecular rotation can be created. Yeah? In general, we observe a broad population distribution. However, still the most weakly bound states are favored. And the population level oscillates with R. All of these results can be found in this kind of in this manuscript available on the archive. Okay, now what do we plan in the future? Yeah, so still we have some open questions for this three-body recombination process. So first of all, we would like to investigate more deeply bound states, and even more, we would like to investigate the dependence of the population distribution on the scattering length. Yeah, so we want to clearly see the change of the population distribution when going from kind of from the resonant interparticle interaction regime going to the non-resonant interparticle interaction regime. For this, one might use perhaps Feshbach resonances. Yeah? And second, we would like to gain control over the recombination process, which means kind of to tune our parameters such that we can kind of precisely kind of accumulate more population in particular states. Okay, however, the presented method is very general. Yeah, so this method can be applied to kind of all sorts of processes producing diatomic molecular product states. Yeah, I mean, the method is just detecting these states and does not care where these states come from. Yeah. So, for example, one can think of perhaps inelastic collisions of molecules. This would be kind of related to the experiments that we do in another experiment in our lab. For example, we have measured kind of, so we have produced triplet rubidium-2 molecules, and then we performed collisions of these molecules in quasi-1D traps. Yeah? And for these molecules, we observed the inelastic loss, and kind of we could determine the reaction rate constants. Yeah? These results are given in this Nature Communications article. However, for this rubidium-2 molecules, nothing is known about possible product states of this kind of this collisional process. Yeah? And this is not only true for rubidium molecules, but also for kind of all other kinds of molecules. So this inelastic loss is kind of observed very clearly, and there's a lot of work about that. However, essentially nothing is known about possible relaxation channels or kind of the final product states produced. So with this, I come to the end of the talk by introducing the team. So the experiments are performed in the group of Johannes Hecker-Denschlag at the University of Ulm. The coupled channel calculations were carried out by Eberhard Thiemann from Hannover. And this three-body recombination model calculations were performed by our collaborators from the US, Brandon Rusick, Yu-Chun Wang, Jose Din Cao, and Paul Julian. So thank you.
We have time for questions.
You said about there must be some interference effect. That means it's mm-hmm. not universal rate. Right?
Yeah. They did not really check for non-universalities. I mean, it's so they have their code where they kind of solve this this problem in kind of in hyperspherical coordinates, and from their solutions they build up the S matrix which connects the input to the output channels, and so there's so they clearly observe this interference, but they cannot say much about kind of.
And I just want to let you know that we worked not this.
Sorry, I didn't
know. We worked with other alkali metal, mm-hmm. maybe alkali metal molecules, the reactions, and we found in all cases there's a chaos in the primer. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It is even there's a total rate is universal, mm-hmm. but because of this complex, mm-hmm. It's chaotic. Mm-hmm. The channels lie very close to each other and they affect each other. Therefore, there is sort of interference in it, so that could also. Mm-hmm.
I mean, they explain it like, I mean, you have this all of these potentials. Yeah, and then, as there are so many, you have lots of avoided crossings and all of these things.
Yeah. Potential. Yeah. They mm-hmm. channels.
Yeah.
To understand a little bit more the microscopic reaction dynamics.
Mm-hmm.
So it can, for instance, from the fact that the spins are not flipped, can one say that the speed of the reaction must be faster than the inverse of the hyperfine interaction? So because that the hyperfine interaction would be the one that could flip spins, and if they are not flipped, then maybe it's just faster than the time scale given by that.
I mean, this is a good question. However, we can estimate kind of the velocities in our sample, and from the density, kind of, how long is the time that the kind of this three particles are close by? But we did not compare this to kind of to timescales that would be necessary for this hyperfine interaction.
How can I imagine the microscopic mechanism? So there are three particles, and then so there's just a soup, and then one goes up. And
yeah, something like that. I mean, they come close by.
Is there anything more detailed about the dynamical evolution of the free body system?
The dynamical evolution. I mean,
when it's close.
This is a kind of essentially. I think there's not too much known about that. I mean, the thing is, they come together, and then they. Kind of, they build this, let's say, this complex. Yeah, then they sample all of the possible output channels in this complex, and at some point they just go out. Yeah, so I mean.
If you had sort of in the outlook said something about doing experiment and you do a state selection, right?
Yeah.
If you do so, then you would be able to identify the dynamics that goes on to making these.
I mean, producing this particular states was more related to the fact that we want to tune the scattering length, and if the population distribution changes with the scattering length, one could kind of increase the population in particular levels and just decrease it in other levels. So.
You don't observe that, right? You don't observe the
particular. I mean, we observe this
part.
I mean, we see the final state. Yeah, this is detected. Yeah, but kind of, we do not see too much about the dynamics. Yeah, so related to his question, I mean, there's not too much known about the dynamics. Though, kind of on a kind of a simulation, how these three body come together and how they react is kind of. Well, I mean, the interaction of this three-body process, I mean, there are, yeah.
But you've got to change densities. So bosons before, bosons after. And then every second level is missing. You have one Girard state, single Girard state.
Yeah, but I mean, I do not know whether it is there that fundamental in our process, or some kind of parity change might be somehow allowed. The fact is that we do not observe any parity change. We see this positive total parity related to these rotational states, and that's it. So in this reaction, kind of no other parity can be formed. Yeah. But I do not really know whether it's kind of there's this such fundamentally forbidden. Yeah.
It's just like if you go to ground state to like V equals to zero, I guess there also every second there will be missing in the result your reaction. Like in heat tube or whatever.
So, okay.
I mean, they absorb the they calculate charge exchange reaction and see the resonance structures, and then we are able to identify it. They also keep specific parents.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the same, right? Mm-hmm. Even for all. So it already noticed a different kind of situation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so other questions? So with that, let's thank our speaker.